Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, خالق الوجود من العدم وجاعل النور من الظلم ومخرج الصبر من الألم وملقي التوبة على الندم فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى بن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم فالحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ به من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا ثم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ووصينا الإنسان بوالديه إحسانا حملته أمه كرها ووضعته كرها وحمله وفصاله 30 شهرا حتى إذا بلغ أشده وبلغ 40 سنة قال ربي أوزعني أن أشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علي وعلى والدي وأن أعمل صالحا ترضاه وأصلح لي في ذريتي إني تبت إليك وإني من المسلمين أولئك الذين نتقبل عنهم أحسن ما عملوا ونتجاوز عن سيئاتهم في أصحاب الجنة وعد الصدق الذي كانوا يوعدون اللهم اجعلنا منهم واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين. Today inshallah ta'ala I want to share with you some brief reflections from a couple of ayat that belong to Surah Al-Ahqaf, a very powerful surah of the Quran. And the first thing I want to share with you about this surah is that it belongs to a group of surahs called the Hawamim. They all begin with Hamim, 7 of them. And the predominant subject of these surahs is basically a debate and a very direct confrontation with people who did not believe in Allah or did shirk with Allah or did not believe in an afterlife or did not believe in Risala. One of the 3 fundamentals of our faith, either something to do with a violation in something to do with believing in Allah or a violation in something to do with the iman in the afterlife, like in hiya illa mawtatuna al-ula that occurs in Surah Al-Dukhan for instance, or in hiya illa hayatuna al-dunya namutu wa nahya. So these kinds of arguments that this is the only life there is no afterlife. Or further, that this idea of a messenger coming from God, this is too crazy, we can't accept this. So that there's a debate happening in these surahs between people who are skeptical about these 3 fundamentals of our faith and Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Allah is teaching His Messenger and through Him us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He's teaching us what to respond with. How to give a response. So these are, you can call them surahs about da'wah and really a methodology of conveying the message of Islam. But in the middle of all of them are ayat about Allah Azza wa Jal teaching us the rights of parents, which seems to be a departure from the overall subject of these surahs. But even in that there's a huge lesson. And that is that du'at, or people that serve deen, you know, they're concerned about the message of Islam being given to others. But there are certain values that can never be overlooked. They have to be paid attention to no matter who we are. Whether we're in a position of teaching other people Islam or we're on the receiving end. And so this refers to all human beings. So Allah Azza wa Jalla in this ayah says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. And everybody who hears this ayah, you know, in Meccan Quran, obviously the predominant audience, the most people that are listening to this, these ayat, are not Muslims. So they're being given a message about the rights of their parents. But also the ones that are reciting these ayat, the students of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Messenger himself, all of them are also cognizant of what is Allah saying to them in these very ayat. So the word insan is applicable here, because it's about all of us, all human beings. And Allah says human beings have been gifted in the beginning in وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. There's some very powerful realities that that deserve reflection. All creatures in this world, and many, many animals in this world, obviously are born of, I'm not talking about microscopic creatures, but this idea of parents giving birth to children is across many species. It's not just human beings. Birds give birth to their offspring. Cows and horses do it, right? So there's the idea of parent and child across many animals. But we're different from them. And now all these other species, yes, there is the mother and it takes care of its young for a little while. And then it becomes independent and they live independent lives. It leaves the nest, it doesn't come back. It starts its own life and they may not even have a relationship with each other after that. The mother and child. And father especially, pretty much no relationship. But we were created different. And Allah instilled in us something that is not put in any other creation. It's something unique to us. This is part of our fitrah. One of the gifts of our fitrah, as some argue based on these ayat. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. That tawsiyah, this wasiyah that comes from Allah Azza wa Jal, isn't just through wahi. That some argue that this is like Allah revealed that we should be good to our parents. Other argue, no, this tawsiyah that's being talked about in this ayah, this will or this advice, this counsel that Allah gave to human beings about their parents was something put inside of them. That was something naturally occurring. Revelation only came to reinforce it. So goodness to our parents is part of us being decent human beings. It's the starting point of our decency. And this is actually important in the conversation about da'wah, because people who did shirk were no good to Allah. And Allah is arguing perhaps the problem is somewhere else. You're not even good to your parents. Those you can see. How can you be good to Allah who you can't see? So وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. Just a little bit about the word ihsan here. Other places in the Quran, ihsan isn't mentioned. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ. There's no mention of ihsan. Or Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا. Husna is also used, but here ihsan is used. There's a difference between them. Ihsan is the most powerful of these terms. And it's used particularly in these surahs, as you will see, that actually very particular kinds of parents are being talked about. Not just all parents. Actually, this passage highlights Muslim parents, believing parents. All human beings should be good to their parents. But above and beyond that, if your parents are Muslim, you should be extra, extra good to them. Goodness to parents is universal, but excellence to parents at the highest levels is expected from those who have been blessed with Muslim parents. Whose parents said La ilaha illallah? Whose parents gave adhan in your ear? The parents who gave adhan in your ear when you were born. The parents who raised you, teaching you how to read Quran, how to make salah, how to make wudu. Those parents deserve special attention, and they're being highlighted in this passage. حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهًا وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. His mother, immediately Allah switches, almost every time, He immediately switches to the favors of the mother and not the father. And that's not for the fathers in the audience, including myself, to feel bad. It's not for that reason. The reason for that is the favors of the father are easy to remember. The father's major contribution in our life actually happens later on in our life. The major contribution of our mother, which continues throughout life, but the biggest part of it is in the beginning, the part we can't remember. Nobody remembers when they were inside their mother. Nobody remembers when she was feeding them. Nobody remembers when she was changing their diaper. Nobody remembers that. We remember when our dad handed us the keys to the car. When the dad gave you $20, you asked for 20 bucks, he gave it to you. When you're dead, you know, so you remember the favors of the father and you recognize that he was providing for the household or taking care of things and things like that. That's easy to recall. But you know, when we think of our mothers, it's so easy to forget what they did. Because we actually, it's easy to forget because we don't physically have memory of that. We don't have it. So Allah reminds us of the part we forget. And He doesn't let us forget. So every time I look at my mother, I should remember what she did for me. How she almost died giving me birth. I can't forget that. Every time. Every time I say salam to her, every time I'm about to get frustrated with her, I'm supposed to remember حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهًا. And it was painful. It was something she didn't want. It was a pain she didn't desire. It was discomfort. Nothing tasted good anymore. She was constantly in a stomach ache and then a backache. And the kinds of pains she goes through. Those of you that are married and have had pregnant wives, you know what I'm talking about. It makes you, when your wife is going through a pregnancy, it makes you appreciate your mother and what she went through. Kurhan. And there's a difference between karh in Arabic and kurh. Karh is actually min al-kharij. And kurh min al-dakhil. Yani there's when something is forced on top of someone, that's karh. But if it's from within, a pain, a difficulty, a dislike, a discomfort from within, that's qur'an. You know, if something's from the outside, like for example, the car is really hot, you can turn the AC on. That's a discomfort from the outside. But the mother's going through a discomfort from the inside. She can't change that. It's within her, you know. So Allah talks about her carrying you. She carried him with such difficulty. And then she bore him. She gave him birth with such difficulty. Just the pangs of birth and labor. Then وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا. On top of that, carrying him and feeding him 30 months, up to 30 months in some cases. And there's a long explanation for why 30 months are mentioned, but this is not the place for it. But I want to highlight some other things here. Those first few years of our life, who remembers? Who remembers when they were 2 years old, barely even speaking anything? Nobody remembers that. But immediately Allah switches over and says, حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ. Until the time where this child has now reached maturity, became a teenager, became a young man. He's mature now, he's an adult now. And this is the age of youth. When bulughul ashud in Arabic is used for when you just leave childhood and have entered manhood. Puberty has hit. You know, the mustache is starting to come in or whatever. That's the age. Now at that age, you know, you feel like your whole life is ahead of you. You know? You look at people that are 20 years old and say, man, those guys are old. You know? And the definition of what is old changes over time, right? So when you're 25, then 25 is young. When you're 40, like, oh, not that old. You know? 50 is old. And, you know, when you get to 50, then 50 seems young. Because you have to tell yourself somehow that there's still good life left ahead of you, you know? Allah Azza wa Jalla says it goes by in a flash. That's why the ataf here is very beautiful. وَبَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً. And he reached 40 years. What? He's just a teenager, a phrase ago. بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ وَبَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً. Not even ثُمَّ بَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً لِلْإِطَالَةً. No, it's not like a long time passed and he reached 40. In the blink of an eye, you look back. Man, I was just in high school. What just happened? I got gray beard coming out now. I got kids of my own. My kid's about to be a teenager. Life passes you by so quickly. And this person in particular is being described, and this is actually a gift both. This is something that we should aspire to be, and it's also a gift to the parents. We pray that our children are like this. He reaches the age of 40, meaning the age of maturity, the age at which he's in charge. And by the way, 40 is also an expression in Arabic for being at the peak of your manhood. Meaning you're in charge of your family, you're in charge of your financial affairs, you're the one taking care of your parents now instead of your parents taking care of you. Everything's been reversed. You're on top. That's the idea in expressing the term 40. Intellectually, materially, financially, physically, you're at a certain kind of peak. And so here Allah Azza wa Jal says, this person turns to Allah, قَالَ رَبِّ أَوْزِعْنِي. Such a beautiful dua. Master, he turns to Allah and says, أَوْزِعْنِي. Waza' in Arabic, they say kaffun nafs an hawaha. They say waza' in Arabic is to stop yourself from something you desire. And from it you get iza' awza'a, the verb here that's being used. That's one of its meanings. Ya Allah, make me stop. One of the meanings of it is amsikni, awqifni, make me stop. Make me stop on what? Whatever he's asking for, he's asking Allah, and through it we're asking Allah, Ya Allah, I want you to put something in my heart. And I want you to put such a love of it in me that once I have it, I don't want anything else. I just stop at that. You know how you have food on your plate and it's enough for you and somebody offers you, say, no, bas. Kafiye. This is enough. This is what I want. Kafa. La ghayru. No more. That's the meaning of awzi'ni. Ya Allah, make me content entirely that I stop at this. If I can just accomplish this much, I'm good. These are the ayat about, you know, by the way, they call about 40, they call it a midlife crisis in the modern society. And people start saying, what have I accomplished in my life? What have I done? I look back at my life, I haven't done anything. This man is learning to ask the dua. This mature believer is learning to ask the dua. Ya Allah, if you can just make me content with these following accomplishments, I'm okay. If I've done something with my life. So what are these accomplishments? And before I go further, awzi'ni also means alhimni, the ulama argue. Awli'ni, waffiqni, you know. It means give me, inspire me. Inspire me. Put a love of something. Awla actually means to instill a love of something. Put a love of something in me. Empower me. Qawwini. Give me the strength to do something. All of these are captured inside this beautiful word, awzi'ni. But the strength to do what? The motivation to do what? The satisfaction to do what? The urge to do what? What? An ashkura ni'matak. That I can thank your favor. Wa an ashkura ni'matak. And this is actually a nuance of the Arabic language, because a shukr in the Arabic language comes with lam or ala. An ashkur ala ni'matik. An ashkur li ni'matik. There's some harf is implied. But here, you know, like for example, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنْ اشْكُرْ لِلَّهِ. There's a lam, you know. But here, أَنْ اشْكُرْ نِعْمَتَكَ مُبَاشَرَةً فَوْرًا. And this suggests something. Ya Allah, make me immediately grateful for your favor. Don't make me think of your favors. Eventually, I realize it was a blessing, and eventually I'll get around to thanking you. Make me someone who has a sense of urgency to want to thank you for your favor. نِعْمَتَكَ التي أنعمت علي, the favor you favored me with. And he hasn't even named that favor. He hasn't even named that favor. Which has many benefits. One of which is, of course, the ultimate favor. Ya Allah, you gave me, in the context of the ayah, you gave me believing parents. What a huge favor you gave me. You gave me this Islam because of my parents. They became a means for me to be able to say, La ilaha illallah. How many people didn't get that? Like the Prophet described, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَأَبَوَاهُ يُهَوِّدَانِهِ أَوْ يُنَصِرَانِهِ أَوْ يُمَجِّسَانِهِ. It's abawah, their parents did that. But my parents gave me Islam. You know, what a huge favor you gave me. Now, you know, when you really understand this ayah, and if I really understand this ayah, every time I look at my father, every time I look at my mother, it makes me say this dua. رَبِّ أَوْزِعْنِي أَنْ أَشْكُرَ نِعْمَتَكَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِ. And it's especially important for the younger guys in the audience when your dad is yelling at you to make this dua. Ya Allah, thank you for my father. Thank you for the gift that is my father. Don't let me forget that. And it's important to note that this in the Quran, that at points where you should have patience, at the times in the Quran where you would expect Allah will talk about patience, He instead talks about gratitude. There's a very nuanced thing in the Quran. Why? Because if you're grateful, patience becomes easy. You know, if you just worry about, oh, I should just be patient, I should just be quiet. Actually, focus your attention on gratitude and sabr will come. If you have a sabr problem, it actually probably means you have a shukr problem. That's what that means. So, an ashkura ni'mataka allati an'amta alay wa ala waliday. And the favor you gave to my parents. Now, there seems to be something common between the favor Allah gave me and the favor Allah gave my parents. What is that common favor? It's la ilaha illallah. That's la ilaha illallah. That's Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's the gift of these words that we can communicate with Allah through. The gift of prayer. The gift of Islam. That you gave to me and you gave to my parents and you made them a means by which I could have. An ashkur ni'matak allati an'amta alayya wa ala walidayya. Our parents do so much for us, it's already been mentioned. The mother does so much for us. But in this particular passage, the gift that our parents are, the parents have given us, is really la ilaha illallah, and that's a priceless gift. There's no more valuable gift than that. You know? We are forever grateful. You know, there are people who, for example, become Muslim because of the da'wah. Allah puts barakah in somebody's da'wah and they become Muslim. And they took shahada on somebody's hand. They are forever ever grateful to that person. They opened, Allah made them the way, the person who opened the door for them. Everything else good that came in their life after that, through their Islam, is a result of that person's effort that Allah put barakah in. Well, who are those people for many of us whose parents are Muslim? It's our parents. They gave us Islam. We're Muslim through them. We owe them our Islam. You know, some of us, you know, we become more knowledgeable than our parents. You know, a lot of young people, mashallah, in this community are students of knowledge. They're studying Arabic, tafsir, ulum, fiqh, etc. And your dad never did that. He's an accountant. He runs a grocery store. He didn't learn that stuff. But you know what? Everything you learn is a byproduct of Allah wants you to be grateful for him. You don't start saying, I know more than my dad. Man, he doesn't even know usul al-fiqh. He doesn't even know, like, 101 aqidah. He doesn't even know like anything about the seerah. You don't do that. You don't do that. Because we have to maintain a humility to our parents because of this dua. You know? And so this attitude, ala waliday, wa an a'mala salihan tardah, that's maturity right there. That is maturity. At the end of the day, you know, when you're younger, you start worrying about, man, I need to learn more, I need to do this, I need to do that, I need to accomplish. And he says, look, Ya Rab, if you can just make me a grateful human being, someone who acknowledges your favor, that's a major accomplishment in my life. I will look back and say, I've accomplished something. I am trying to do as much shukr as I can. Second, that Ya Allah, empower me, inspire me, give me a sense of urgency, make me satisfied with doing good things that make you happy. I don't care what people think. I don't care what people think. So long as you're happy, I'm happy. Ya Allah, make me happy to do things that make you happy. This is an a'mala salihan tardahu. You know, people, I'm choosing a path, I'm choosing a career, I'm making a business decision that makes you happy. My family's against it, my friends are against it, the economy's going in a different direction, but I know you're gonna be happy with this. Ya Allah, put it in my heart that that decision makes me happy, and I never think, what if? What if I chose another path? Don't make me think like that. أَوْزِعْنِي أَنْ أَعْمَلَ صَالِحًا. It's like, it's continuation of أَوْزِعْنِي. Ya Allah, stop me at that. There's no, you shouldn't put what if in me. You know, for a lot of people who chose a path, they chose a particular path, what happens to them? You know, their parents might come and say, or their elders might come and say, or somebody else might, you could have had a real career, man. You were so smart. What did you do? What did you do with your life? Well, I decided to, you know, serve deen. Or I decided to do something that will benefit Muslims instead. It doesn't make as much money at all, but I decided to serve the ummah. Well, you could have been somebody. Why did you do that? You know? I met doctors that decided to join Doctors Without Borders, and they were heads of departments at hospitals on their way to being like the CEOs of hospitals. And they left that to go join Doctors Without Borders, which pays basically nothing. You go on your own dime. And the family's in crisis. Why are you doing this? This is wrong. You could have been, oh my God, and you could help so many more people with your money. He goes, I don't want to help with my money. I want to do things that make Allah happy. I want to satisfy the needs of my soul. وَأَنْ أَعْمَلَ صَالِحًا تَرْضَاهُ. This is a dua, because a lot of people, when they take a good direction and they start doing something good, they start feeling like, man, I'm missing out on dunya. I could have been doing something else. Maybe I shouldn't get too involved. Maybe I should put the brakes on a little bit, you know? أَنْ أَعْمَلَ صَالِحًا تَرْضَاهُ is a very powerful statement. Then وَأَصْلِحْ لِي فِي ذُرِّيَّتِي. Please move up, there are people standing in the back, inshallah. There's some open spaces over here, so move up. Be courteous to your fellow community. So وَأَصْلِحْ لِي فِي ذُرِّيَّتِي. Subhanallah. Now he says, Ya Allah, make my, and I'll try to translate as literally as I can. Ya Allah, make my matters good, make things right for me through my children. Make my account good through my children. He's not even asking for his children. Actually, أَصْلِحْ لِي فِي ذُرِّيَّتِي. He's asking for himself. A real Muslim parent understands that you and I are trying to raise good children, not for them, but for ourselves. This is actually our real investment in the Akhirah. If I can be happy trying to please Allah, Ya Allah, make sure my account, even if I do well, but I did a lousy job raising my children, Ya Rab, I don't want that. Give me good children. Make them fix my account, so the holes, the gaps I had in my good deeds, the laziness I showed, the sadaqah jariyah I will leave when I'm in the grave and they continue to do good deeds, should fix up my account. أَصْلِحْ لِي فِي ذُرِّيَّتِي. And ذُرِّيَّة is not even my أولادي. ذُرِّيَّة is future generations, 5, 6, 7 generations from now. This is the midlife, not crisis, but realization. The guy reaches 40 and realizes he doesn't have much time left on the planet. I need to start thinking about my real long-term investments. And my real long-term investments for myself are deeds that will make Allah happy. And beyond my own lifetime, if I can just have children who will raise good children, who will raise good children, who will raise good children. If I could do that, Ya Allah, I think I did something in my life. I accomplished something. I may not have been able to buy a beautiful house. I may not have been able to get the nicest car. I may not have had the most amount of money, but I got out of this life what I needed. I got what I needed, subhanAllah. This is the maturity of a human being that has been blessed with parents. And this is the best of both worlds. Parents good in all, I'll put in a lot of work, and the child comes out the way they should. In a couple of minutes that I have left, there's the flip side of it in this khutbah, in this passage that I won't get to, but it's really painful. It really is. These are ayat worth reading and reflecting upon. On the other side are parents that are believers, that did their best to raise a child, but the child just
does not care about this deen. And Allah is teaching us that you will make dua, but that doesn't guarantee that all of your du'as will be answered. Even Ibrahim alayhi salam made dua for good children. He did, and even he was told. Even he was told, you know, amma man zalam. Actually, the one among them who does wrong, I'm not, you know, la yanalu ahdi al-zalimin. My guarantee does not extend to wrongdoers. Your children, those that mess up, they'll make their own choice. You can make dua, yes. I'll give you some, but don't think it's guaranteed. And also we learn from that, we don't control the iman of our children. Nuh alayhi salam cannot control the iman of his son. That's something that comes from Allah and a decision that he or she has to make, the child has to make. That's a choice, and this is a country about choices, right? So we have to equip our youth to be able to make that right choice. But what I wanted to leave you with is these final ayat about just the same person who made this beautiful dua. He says, "Ulaika." Allah says about him, "Ulaika nataqabbalu alladhina nataqabbalu anhum ahsana ma amilu." So awesome. Those are the people that Allah says we will accept from them the best of what they did. And anhum is used as opposed to minhum, which, because I have 1 minute, I can't talk about. But I will tell you some things. You know, in many of you that are students, when you take like the average of your grades at the end, like you had five exams and your teacher is going to average all five exams and then give you your grade. Or your teacher says, so which of these five exams did you do the best in? Okay, there's one exam, exam number two, you got a 90. Everything else, you got a 40. And he says, you know what? I'm going to give you a 90. I'm going to grade you based on the best thing you did. And you're like, really? All my four exams were 40s, 20s. I mean, I thought, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And you took my one exam that I got a 90 in, and you're saying my overall grade is a 90? That is a really, really nice teacher. And clearly giving you and me something we absolutely don't deserve. Allah says those people who reach that kind of maturity, who are that sincere to Allah and good to their parents, if they become like that and they can accomplish that kind of gratitude and they can try to do things that please Allah and they can make that kind of sincere dua for their children and asking Allah to help fix how they can raise their children, those people, Allah will reward them based on the best that they did. So maybe some Ramadan you did well, some Ramadan you did pretty badly. Some salah you prayed not so well, some salah you prayed amazing, you were crying in the salah, you were making dua to Allah, you were closer to Allah than you've ever been, and Allah is willing to offer you the reward of all of your prayers based on that one. Based on that one, subhanAllah. What a mercy from Allah. What a gift from Allah to these people. So, you know, I was trying to get across to you, if you can accomplish this, if I can accomplish this, it means something. Then I can say that I've done something with my life, and this is worth it. This is worth it right here. نَتَقَبَّلُ عَنْهُمْ أَحْسَنَ مَا عَمِلُوا وَنَتَجَاوَزُ عَنْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ. And above and beyond that, we will overlook their mistakes, overlook their big sins. But even when Allah says, He'll look over their sayyi'at, what about their dhunub? What about their khati'at? There are lesser things. So if just because you overlooked the big sins, what about the little things? You're still left worried. So the relief from Allah comes immediately in the ayah says, Fee ashabil jannah. No. I will overlook your big mistakes and guaranteeing you, you're going to be among the people of Jannah immediately. So you don't even have to worry, am I going to eventually get Jannah? No, these people, I will put you in Jannah. I'm giving you fi ashabil jannah. Wa'da al-sidq. Really, really, really. It's a true promise, I'm telling you. The mansub is called ala al-ighra. I'm telling you, it's a real promise. Are you listening? Wa'da al-sidq. Alladhi kanu yu'adun. The one that they've been promised. This is a promise of Allah to us. What are we learning in this beautiful passage? What dua can do to your life and my life in this world and in the next? What real dua can do? What really turning to Allah can do? How our affairs can entirely be changed if we just learn to ask Allah with the right etiquette. And we ask the right things with the right heart with an intent to change ourselves. Don't just make dua without keeping status quo. There are things you and I do that don't please Allah. We know it. We have to be able to admit that to ourselves. We have to be honest to ourselves. If you can't be honest to yourselves, then the knowledge isn't worth anything. Then these duas are worth nothing. These du'as are worth something when you ask Allah, Ya Allah, I am trying to change, help me make this change happen. I'm doing my part, you give me your divine assistance above and beyond what I can do. Help me get away from these evil things. Help me get away from, you know, these flaws that I have, these wrongs that I do. Help me become better to my parents. I'm trying. Ya Allah, help me even further. I know I have a temper problem. I'm trying to clamp it down. Ya Allah, give my heart even more tranquility above and beyond what I'm capable of. And Allah will. For the people who try, Allah gives. Allah gives. You know. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Allah opens doors for people that make an attempt. So I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal makes us people that make that kind of attempt. My request to all of you would be, as when you go home today, inshaAllah ta'ala, share these beautiful ayat with your family. Read them and reflect upon them on your own. This is Suratul Ahqaf. And these are ayat number 15 onwards. So just a reading of it on your own, inshaAllah ta'ala, will bring you closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. And if you have the time this week, try and memorize these du'as. Memorize these ayat. Recite them in your prayer. It brings you closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa khususan ala afdalihim wa khatamin nabiyyin Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Yaqulullahu Azza wa Jal fi kitabihi al-Kareem ba'da naqula a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. Inna allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim fil alamin innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammadin وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا